You're not rocking with Big Oosh Radio. We are live on the line. It is your host, Boogie Oogie Oogie. Alongside me, I got my beautiful co-host. Go ahead, Oosh, introduce yourself.
Big Oosh Manny, Annie.
I'm not even going to say the Annie's anymore, bro.
I know, man.
Well, I don't want to watch that back. He's like, Manny, Annie. Like, silly. It sounded weird coming out of my mouth, man. What's going down, Mosso?
I'm chilling, Oosh. You see over here rocking the new gear.
Ooh, I see you, bro. You're looking nice in that 808, son. Got that royal blue.
Did they tell you, Oosh, our shirts make people look buff, too? So look at that.
Charlie, you look super swole, you know? Nah. What's going on, everybody on the live? We'll give you guys a couple seconds to tap in.
Yes, sir.
If you're just tuning in, welcome to another segment of Jerusalem High Big Oosh Radio. We want you to do a couple things. We need you to hit that share button right now. I'm gonna do that right now, Manny.
I'm already done, bro.
You done? That was man. You moving quick, bro.
Done.
All that buffness, Oosh.
I almost broke my screen, bro. Totally. You know what I'm saying?
What's up, Oosh T? I see you live on the line, James, brother James. What's going down, man? Brent, what's up, Brent?
That's my uncle, Oosh. James Bryce, bro.
James Bryce, what's up, James? What's up, uncle?
All in Australia, bro.
Wow, Australia?
Yeah, we were talking the other day, and he was like, bro, I share you guys' podcast all over here, and people be watching and tuning in. So that's love, man. Thanks, Unc.
That's what's up. Appreciate that is that. Love. Yeah. All the way from Australia.
Yeah, and he ordered shirts, bro, and their area code got four numbers in it.
Oh, suddenly, what's the area code there in Australia?
I think it's 3065. Or 64, wow. Something like that, yeah.
Like a state penitentiary inmate number. 403. Inmate 478910. Check it in. Shout out to Uncle James all the way in Australia. Tapping in. We got your merch, and we definitely did you. So we got his little area code
got
in there
him.
Too, right?
Got him.
That's love, there. Bro. Yeah. Jeremiah, what's up, Jeremiah, man? What's up, Jeremiah?
Puka.
Brother Jeremiah,
brother
man.
Jesse's on.
Jesse, which Jesse?
Oh, Jesse Koke.
Oh, what's up, Jesse?
That's him watching from Vice.
Oh, that's Jesse. Okay, yeah. Jess, let's just settle score right now, Jess, because Jess was on the live on Friday night for King of the Ox. Who won King of the Ox? If you were on King of the Ox, we want you guys to let us know, right? Because I just kind of dubbed myself. I felt like, okay, where was Wally Humble? I woke up.
Uh-huh. I was like, man, what a fun night. You know what I mean? Friendly competition. Everything was good. Except for the hateration part, Oosh.
Mm-hmm.
So I look at my phone and I see this new post on Big Oosh on Big Oosh page, Oosh. And it said that we had a new crown king for the King of the Ox. Oosh.
Somebody had to be king.
You're right.
Right? Like somebody had to be king.
Even friendly competition, somebody gotta win, bro.
DJ Una's in the building. What's up, Una?
He's a DJ. Ask
DJ. Because after the live, man, my wife was like, I think Manny kind of got you there, man. I was like, wow. You're not team Boogie Oogie Oogie? She's like, I think Manny kind of got you. Then I was like, oh, man.
Brent said it was a tie.
What'd Jeremiah say? Yes, Silly, go ahead, Jeremiah. My little book. It was a tie. Yeah, well, you know what? We'll take the tie. I apologize. I'll retract the post with dubbing myself. We'll share the crown. How about that?
Hey, I thought Boog won with the chilling on the west. Oh, that was a classic right there. He got the whole west side on that.
I mean, but through and through, man.
Talalo's in the house.
We see y'all. Through and through, man. We
both Una said Boog got night. It. See, Boog, you were right. It was right for you to crown yourself, bro.
Okay. He said... Jesse I want to see what Jesse said.
Jesse said, without being biased, Manny.
We'll take that. I know. I will take that. Okay, we'll take that. Jess, I love you, man. I know you'll be honest, too, man. That's why I'm asking. Jess,
so but look, thank I'm going to put, I'm gonna put on the crown right now.
Oh, suddenly. Nobody should put that on, nigga.
This is my crown, Oosh.
Oh, Gina's not biased, too. She said, man. Wow.
Let's go.
Okay, you know what? The king of the ox is Manny. We will create another post and post it tomorrow. We'll give it to Manny.
First of all, I'd like to thank my family. I'd like to thank the Lord for this journey. It's been a long time coming.
DJ Una said I got him on one up on the last song. Buff off the tight. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Mal Wizzo, I see you, Maui.
Oos, you're interrupting my speech.
My bad, Oos. Go ahead. Continue.
Nah, go ahead.
Continue.
Momo na avale vinga ma lefaf tai de tua. You didn't know up, bro.
I see you, bro. I see you, bro. I see you. I see you. Make sure if you're just joining us, make sure you guys hit that share button, man. We got a dope show lined up for y'all, man. Yeah.
We're trying to build up the viewership right now because we got a special guest on tonight.
Absolutely, absolutely. But if you rock, story. If you rock with us on Fire Fridays, man, thank you for rocking with Manny and I. Yeah. We had a great time, man. Just chilling, man. Outside of the haters that were, you know, reporting our live, man. Thank y'all, man. Like we said earlier, thank y'all for reminding us that we are doing our thing. And like a much appreciation to like the folks that DJ, because DJing is we've learned that's a lot. It's not an easy job, man.
Yeah.
So like keep the crowd hype, because I saw like there were some joints that I played. I thought like, oh, it was on. And then like Eddie was like, oh, boo. I was like, wow, Eddie, you gonna do me like that?
I think Eddie was being biased, because we're from the 808.
Oh, wow.
I think he was being biased, and we grew up together. So
man, I thought it was game recognized game. I thought it was game recognized game.
Exactly. That's why we gotta go with Jesse Hughes. Because
Game recognized game.
But he said that I won.
And he said that you won. So, ladies and gentlemen, the newly crowned king of the Ox is now Manny. No Annie. How about that? Manny,
it don't
no
even
Annie.
Matter, man. That episode was so dope. I had so much fun. I called Boog like 2 days later, and I said, Sola, I'm rewatching the episode again. We was playing the cuts.
Oh, we had. I had a good time, man. Hopefully, if you was tapped in on Friday night, you had a good time. Maui said rematch. You know, we're going to do that. We're going to do that some more. We're definitely going to do that some more. So just stay locked in. And if anybody, like we said, if anybody wants, if it feels like they have a playlist that can level up, please, we would
challenge
welcome
us.
You onto Big Oos Radio. Come and rock
you.
With us.
I dare you. I dare you.
DJ Specialist, if you want to see me, DJ Specialist.
So that's a whole nother level.
That's a whole nother level. I'll get body. We'll get body bagged by DJ Specialist. Oh, man, that boy is nice.
Intro.
Shout out to Specialist out in the 801. Yeah, shout out to Utah.
Real.
That boy is definitely
that's
doing
a
his
bad man right
out of Utah,
there.
Man. Make sure y'all go follow him.
And his son. And his son. What is his son that does the MC while he's a dog or something like that?
I think he plays for Utah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's some place for I've Utah. Shout out to Specialist. Yeah. I actually see Specialist on the live, man. Specialist is no joke. Y'all go follow DJ Specialist. That boy is nice.
That's a bad man. Yep.
What's going on, Specialist? I was just saying, Manny was just saying how he was just calling you out. Manny was just calling you out. He said he wanted to go heads up in the DJ. But I said, Manny, don't do it, Oos. And
see,
if I don't want Manny,
his son dog,
DJ Specialist.
His son's on the mic too, bro.
But nonetheless, welcome to Jerusalem High. Thank you for rocking with us this past week. And we have a very, very special guest on today's show. Now, usually I introduce the guest. Manny, we're going to give you an opportunity. Can you please introduce our guest today?
No, Oos, you know why? Because you do such a great job introducing guests and the build-up and all of that. No, for real, Oos. Oos, when you introduce people, Oos, I sit here and I watch, Oos. It's dope the way you do it, Oos.
Coming to the BUR stage. Ladies and gentlemen, she has the big bat for the UCLA Bruins. Put your hands together for Genevieve Perez. Genevieve, what's going
baby.
Down? Nothing much, you know, just tuning in with you guys. So I'm really looking forward to this since you guys reached out to me. So,
man, it's so great to have you, Genevieve. Thank you for taking the time to be on. Be on Big Oos Radio, Jerusalem High. I want to thank you for being on, and we're excited about this time with you. So tell us a little bit about yourself. Where are you from? Where's your family from?
So I'm Genevieve Perez. I'm from Garden Grove, California. My mom is from Garden Grove, California. My dad's from Santa Ana, California. You know, we're just based out here in Orange County. Mm-hmm. As far as like my roots wise, I have from my Samoan side, my family's from, they're from, oh my gosh, why am I forgetting this? They're from Ta'u Mangu on American Samoa, and then from my Native American side, we're Apache Mascaleros from New Mexico.
Wow.
Native,
you're off Kashi, right?
Yeah.
That's dope, man. How much do you know about your Samoan side in comparison to your native side?
I've been still learning about my Native American side. For as far as like my Polynesian side, I know originally my great grandma and my uncle Kennedy had came over to the States, and then shortly after my great grandpa followed, but you know, still work in progress of learning and learning my family lineage and everything.
I never met a Samoan native. So that's the first time. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you, Genevieve.
That's dope. That's dope. That's dope.
For real.
That's super dope, man. I mean, it's dope that you know, these two just great cultures and heritage fused together, man. Right. And like, I know a lot of, shout out to all my native family. And so I grew up with some of my family members who are also part Samoan and part native. So like, I got to learn a lot about the native culture and heritage through them. So that's so dope. So talk to us. You grew up, where did you grow up?
Garden Grove, California. I've always lived in Orange County my entire life. And, you know, I just love it out here. So grew up just, it's a regular Garden Grove, you know, mm-hmm. I guess regular Garden Grove life, went to school out here. And then first time I went away from home was actually when I went to college in San Diego. And then now I go to college in LA. So yeah, I've been very based out of Orange County my entire life.
What high school did you go to?
Garden Grove High School.
Oh, Garden Grove High School.
Everything Garden Grove, Oos.
Everything's Garden Grove.
Garden Grove.
And you currently reside in Garden Grove right now, right?
Yes. So
that's so dope.
When I go out to school at UCLA, I actually commute every day. So I got a nice 45-minute drive there and then a nice 2.5-hour drive home. So LA traffic is no joke at all.
No joke. That 110, boy.
Oh, man, no, the four crazy. Even worse. Oh, my gosh.
So what was it like growing up in Garden Grove? Talk to us about, like, your experience growing up in that area, in that part of California.
I would say that my parents gave me everything that I needed. And, you know, obviously I didn't get everything that I wanted, which I don't think, and like, every kid should get every single thing that they want. Like, my parents, we had a very, they, like, I was happy growing up as a kid, you know. I had my mom and my dad around, and we've been very close to all my family before we all kind of like spread out, because I got family all over the United States. I can tell you every single state. But yeah, growing up with a lot of family around here, and I'm still close to all my family that like slowly moved away from Orange County. So
That's dope. And so growing up in Orange County, you went to Orange County High School, you said, we all know, right? It's obvious, we know you play fast pitch, right? Did you play any other sport?
So originally I actually first started playing soccer, but that didn't go out too well because it was a little too much running for me at that age. And then I actually tried basketball. I kind of stuck with basketball for a little while, and then I eventually went to softball, and then I think I didn't start until 9, which actually is a little bit later than most, you know, college players now than when they started. And you know, when I was that young, my parents were like, you know what, you could either play basketball or you can play softball. So I was like, oh, I'll try softball, and then kind of stuck with it. They were like, you know, you're pretty good. So I just kept playing, and then slowly developed, you know, the skill, and I never turned back. So I still love the game so much, and I loved it. I love it now as much as I did when I was 9. So
So you played like on the travel team and stuff?
Yeah, I actually started out at the Garden Grove Rec League right here in Garden Grove, California, and then eventually went to travel ball. Then I played for Firecrackers Rico. This is the last team that I played with before I graduated, and then went to San Diego State, and then graduated with my bachelor's degree. Now I'm working on getting my master's at UCLA.
That's what's up.
That's so dope. Let's salute to Genevieve Perez, ladies and gentlemen. So talk to us about that.
Being hungry, man.
Right. Coming out of Garden Grove, did you get a scholarship to play at San Diego?
Yes. So I got a scholarship. I ended up playing there for, well, technically 3 years. I was there for 4, got pregnant my senior year, and then graduated while I was, man, I think like 9 months pregnant, like just before I was about to pop, and then had my baby a month after I graduated from my undergrad. So.
So let's rewind that. Let's talk a little bit about that. So you were at San Diego State the first two or 3 years, right?
Yeah.
And then where's the connection between San Diego State and UCLA? How did you get from?
So I actually went to San Diego State. Like originally, that's where I was planning on playing my 4 years. And, you know, when I committed there, I never looked back. I loved it as SDSU. You know, the coaching staff really supported me throughout my entire journey there, you know, very communicative with me. And, you know, I just have such strong roots based out of SDSU, and I'm so thankful that I went there. I ended up actually getting pregnant about halfway through my senior year. So we're a spring sport. So I got pregnant during the fall. And I broke the news to them probably around December, like right when I found out is when I told them too. So I ended up sticking around. I was with the team, went to every practice. I even was still working out with the team until I was, God, I think like 6 months pregnant. And that was just because the doctor told me I needed to stop working out.
Because
I wasn't able to have a baby at that time. So, you know, I stuck my head around at SDSU as much as I could because I still wanted my teammates to know that I supported them. I graduated with my bachelor's degree from there. Then I ended up taking a year and a half off, and I randomly got a call from the UCLA coach, one of my coaches now, Coach Lisa Fernandez. And she was just like, "Hi, is this Genevieve?" I was like, "Yeah, who is this?" She was, "This is Lisa Fernandez. And if you follow softball or know anything about softball,
you know who Lisa is.
She is the GOAT. Everybody knows her as
wow.
So I was just kind of like, "Oh yeah, give me a second." And I was kind of like, I had the phone like this and I was like, because I was super starstruck. I was surprised. Yeah, and then the first thing she said to me after that was, "Do you want to play UCLA softball?" And I was like, "Yeah, give me a second." And I was like, "What?
Wow."
It literally just fell in my lap out of nowhere. And, you know, I'm so blessed this day. And
yeah,
you ask anybody that's, you know, in my inner circle that, like, they know that I'm so, so, so proud to be a part of this softball program. It's something that's very near and dear to my heart, and they really helped me find myself, like, as a mom. Versus, like, at SDSU, I found myself, like, as, like, a young woman, like, just about to ready to spread my wings and, you know, live my big girl life, and then kind of got hit with a curveball. And then at UCLA, they definitely helped me find out who I am as a mom and reminded me who I was before I had a baby. So I...
That's so dope. Talk to us about that experience, like being your third year and then finding out that you're pregnant. And I mean, right, you're thinking you've got this future ahead of yourself, but then, right, this happens. Like, talk to us about that moment. Like, what was going through your mind in terms of, like, next steps? Like, talk to us about that experience.
So the first thing that I thought of was, oh my gosh, is this actually happening? And I think I had to take, like, I asked the doctor like three times. I was like, "Are you sure? Are you sure those are my tests? Like, are you absolutely sure?" And I was so surprised. Like, I honestly can't even explain like how I felt in that moment. And then when I broke it to my parents, you know, at first it was a little rough because we had like such, I felt that like the typical stereotype that when I have a kid, like I kind of had to give up on everything that I wanted to do, kind of, you know, veer left and just, you know, be a mom. So I had actually originally felt like I kind of lost myself when I first had my son, because going from being an athlete to doing, you know, feeling like the world was my oyster to having a kid. And I felt like I was so limited on what I could do. And on top of it, I actually had to get emergency C-section. So having the surgery was really tough on my psyche too. And I felt like I was just in a very like dark place just because I was so limited on what I could do. And then when this opportunity fell in my lap, I was like, it took me a little while to kind of say yes, because I was like, you know what? I feel like I have to be around my kid to be a good mom. Like, I have to be around him 24/7. So just like the typical stereotype. So I like am really trying to stand for, you know, breaking that stereotype and just showing everybody that just because you have a kid, it's not like you have to stop on your dreams and you have to completely. You have to, it's kind of like an extra motivation for me, if anything. And I actually had to reach out to there's actually another girl before me who played in the NCAA at Cal State Fullerton. Her name is Trish Parks. And she had a son as well. And I think she played her last 2 years with her son. And I reached out to her and I was like, "Dude, how did you do it? Like, you know, I'm going into this and I just want to try to get as much information as I can." She's like, "Honestly, it's just something you got to figure out for yourself." And yeah, it was a crazy journey. And finding out that I was pregnant, it was just really tough. And I thought like my life was over and I was only going to be able to, you know, stay home and be a mom all the time. And, you know, be my life was just filled with diapers and bottles for the rest of my life.
I now, love that.
Yeah. And then now obviously it's so much more. And it's just he's an amazing influence in my life. And I'm so grateful. He is a true definition of God's timing is always perfect.
Oh, that's so dope. And we've seen some pictures of him. Tell everybody your son's name, please.
His full name is Levi Salimau Say Perez Fatolia. He is a 3'3", 45-pound crazy child that I swear he could run through walls. Exaggerating. Like everybody who knows and has seen Levi knows, like if he got into a fight with the wall, he would win.
Yeah. What was that experience like? Like knowing you're pregnant, going through that whole ordeal, thinking about school and finishing, also mm-hmm. thinking about the future, and then Levi arrives. Like, talk to us about that moment.
Well, when Levi arrived, it was just at that point in my pregnancy, I had just felt so like miserable, but just because I had gotten so big and like I felt like compared to different like other pregnant people or pregnant women, I just felt like so humongous. And I was like, dang, I only have one baby in here. And I had to like hold my stomach and walk around and because he was so heavy. And then the doctor's like, yeah, I think you already know, but you're going to have a big baby. And I was like, yeah, I kind of figured, you know, his dad's like 6'3", like 275. So I wasn't expecting anything less. And when he arrived, he didn't really give me a newborn face. He came out and he was already holding his head up when we were still in the hospital. He was already drinking like 6 ounces when he was 2 days old. And he definitely sets the curve for his age. And, you know, he's a ball of energy. He'll go and go and go until his battery's out. And even when his battery's out, he will still push to keep doing what he wants to do. So
that's amazing. I want to circle back to what you were talking about earlier, because I think there's a deep message in what you shared about life ending or having that feeling like life is ending because something happened. I don't want to, you know, a lot of times we word it as my life stopped because something went wrong. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with having a kid and getting pregnant, you know, none of that. So I think the right verbiage was something didn't go as planned.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
And I love what you said when you said, just because there's a curveball that's thrown at you and that's life, right? It doesn't mean you stop giving up on your, it doesn't mean you give up on your dreams. It doesn't mean that stuff stops. What, you know, the Bible says, I want, you know, because we're people of faith, right?
Yeah.
The Bible talks about what the enemy meant for evil. Mm. God can turn it around for good.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? And so just because we get off track a little bit, you know, as long as we stay focused on God, we can be rerouted like the GPS, yes. Right? Every time we take a wrong left or a wrong right, we can always, it'll always take us back to our destination mm-hmm. if we stay the course. And yeah. So I really love what you're talking about because there's a lot of people on the live who may have gone through this, right? Mm-hmm. And even for me, you know, I'm listening to your story and it's almost relative to mine because, you know, me and Gina, Boog knows, you know, we had a baby before we got married. And you know how the whole culture thing is, sometimes you get forced into marriage because you had a baby. You get forced to, now you got to go work. Now you got to quit school. Now you got to do this. Now you got to do that. And we forget the destination. We forget the goal at the end of the journey. And so just because life throws these curveballs at you, I love what you said. Do not give up on you. That doesn't mean stop on what you're supposed to be pursuing. So thank you for that.
Did you feel any of that or those pressures? Like, did you feel pressure?
Absolutely, yeah. Yes. As far as like my relationship wise with my boyfriend, who's also Levi's dad, we didn't get forced into marriage. So thankfully, like our families were understanding in that point, just because like him and I have gone through our relationship problems, as does everybody else.
Right, right.
So we've been working things out and we kind of just let our relationship kind of go where, you know, God means for it to go. And thankfully, you know, we're on a good path. So he's an amazing father to Levi, and you know, he likes teaching him stuff that he shouldn't be doing, you know, dang guy. But I like to think boys will be boys, and you know, I'm just glad, you know, he has that relationship with his dad and they love each other so much, and I swear they're twins, and it's like, Everyone always says, "Oh my gosh, he looks just like you." It's like, yeah, you only say that until you see his dad, and then I'll show him a picture of his dad, and they'll be like, "Oh yeah, no, he looks like him, not you." So, just like being able to, and I'm so glad to have him on my side too, to help break that stereotype of like, you know, you have a baby, you have to get married, you have to drop everything. And you know, I even talked to him about that. Like, I told him, I was like, I don't want us to be forced into anything because we have a baby. We shouldn't have to change our course in life just because we have a kid together, you know. And I'm just so glad that, you know, we're both of our families are very understanding in that
That's good.
sense. So we just
Yeah.
doing what's best for Levi and, you know, what's best for ourselves. And thankfully, you know, that's all on the same path with all of us together. So I thank God every day that my family, you know, that we get to communicate with each other and, you know, just live and, you know, have fun every day. So
That's good.
that's so dope because I know, and Manny and Manny kind of touched upon it as well. A lot of folks who have a child, like it definitely changes the course of like what was intended for their future in the first place, right? And so, and then like I talk to some folks now, and I got family members, I got close friends who are like, man, you know, right? And I like some of them who are also athletes too, like some of them, I look at them right, just because I know their story personally, and like, man, you should have been in the league, you should have went to college and played ball at that level, right? But because you right, and so to hear your story is super, super
It is.
inspiring, man. And
It is.
I want to thank you for, you know, sharing that your story, because it's like, you know, just one, allowing yourself to be vulnerable to share that intimate part of your story. I think it's super important because there might be somebody who's on this live or somebody that might watch this later who might be experiencing or might be going through the same thing. So thank you for, you know, your just ability to persevere and just like look at Levi and say, all right, because I love you, Levi, I'm not gonna give up on my dreams, yo.
That's
You know
good.
what I mean? I'm gonna push, I'm gonna make it. And here you are. You're playing ball for UCLA. Like you played for two just great institutions, and you see, I mean, I'm an SC fan, but kudos to you, right? And playing for an institution like UCLA, which is a huge college, man. That is just so dope. And you're not just playing for them; you're putting it down for UCLA. So before we get into a little more, I want Manny just to, if you can, for folks if you don't know who Genevieve is, you've been living under the rock, but we're going to play a little clip for our viewers real quick so you can see what Miss Genevieve can do.
All right.
Did you share your sound, bro?
Sorry, let me do that again.
Okay.
I was over here enjoying the video by myself. I thought everybody
You
saw it.
sure was.
Hold on, real quick. My bad, guys.
Oh, no worries. I got
There
time.
we
I have a
go.
babysitter, so it's okay.
There we go.
Oh,
I
hi,
think we're
Mom.
good
I
now.
know she's watching this.
Hey, Mom.
We good?
Bree Perez is a 400 hitter, and that's subpar right now in the lineup. That'll get through the left side. One run is in. That'll do it for that at bat. And UCLA is on the board. 0-2, right back up the middle. That'll bring in one. They'll try and score another and do so as Gooden also motors in from second. And the two-run single for Perez. And she'll just go ahead and take second as Cutting was unsure about where to throw it. Ooh. Genevieve Perez, deep shot to left and out of here. Second home run of the tournament, and it's 5-0. And what have the Bruins discovered here? The only misstep, dropping the Jolly Rancher. What an addition for UCLA. Laced out to right and down the line. That'll score a run, and Jordan motors into second with the RBI double. Two-out rally here for UCLA.
Okay, Genevieve, I see you. Talk to us about that moment, because I see your teammates all running up to home plate. What was that moment like? Because that was against Georgia. Was that, and that was like in February, right?
Yeah, that, I think that one was actually my second home run. And I remember that just every home run that I did hit this past season, just my teammates just showered me with so much love. And and it's just so amazing. And like every single one of these girls on the team is my, they're all my sisters, and I'll do anything, you know, anything that I can do for them, anything that they need. And it's just, they support me so much, and they all love Levi so much. They love him just like they're all, you know, they're all his aunties too. So they just all shower him with so much love when, because there is some times where I do have to take him up with me to LA to practice. And, you know, our team managers will just run around with him and watch him for a little while. And then, you know, he kind of does his own thing on the sidelines. And I'm just so thankful that every single person has been so accepting that of the fact that I do have a child, and they're bringing both of us in with open arms. And they just,
so dope.
You know, love us so much. And I can't ever, like, I can't be any more thankful for every single one of them and everybody else within my village. And helps make this opportunity just even possible, because there's a lot of things that happen behind the scenes that we, you know, have to work out, you know, pick up, drop off times, who's watching who, like who's watching Levi these days. And, you know, just everything. It's just, I'm so thankful. That's all I can say with that.
Well, you know what you are too is walking and living proof that you can do it.
Absolutely.
Just because, you know, life throws its hardest punch or whatever life may throw at you, you're doing it. You're doing it right now.
Yeah, there's some of my teammates actually asked me, like, how do I do it? And, you know, they're like, it's hard being a student athlete enough versus being a mom on top of it. And it's a little different because I'm actually in grad school and they're still all doing their undergraduate. And I tell them, like, they really motivate me to, you know, stay strong on top of, you know, my family at home. So it just, I just love them all so much, to the fact that they love me so much to accept my story and, you know, continue to motivate me every single day and push me when they know and visibly can see that I'm tired. And, you know, they know the struggles from whenever I have to bring Levi to practice, and they know like how hard it is on me being away from him. And, you know, sometimes it's like nice to get a little bit of me time. And this is just something that I'm doing for me and my son. And it just kind of like brought me and reminded me who I was and, you know, coming back. And like I said before, I'm so, so, so thankful for every single person that helps me make this possible. And I just try to tell them every day that it's all about your mindset. If you're going to wake up with a bad attitude, then you're going to have like a bad day and
talk to them
like that. So
yes, sir.
It's all about your mentality. And if you do have the right mentality and then you do have that support behind it, then you can honestly do anything with or without a kid. Yeah. So that's just something that I try to live and breathe every day and show my teammates and just anybody that I come in contact with that, you know, it's all about what's up here, and then how hard, like how bad do you want it to make it
happen? That's so dope. One of my favorite quotes by one of the greatest linebackers to ever play, Ray Lewis, said, "The only disability in life is a bad attitude." So all joking aside, with, you know, how I support the Ravens, and, you know. But I mean, it's a statement that stands out to me. So I want to thank you. I also saw on the live, somebody mentioned, I think it was Gina, Manny's wife. She said it takes a village, and like, thank you to your village. You mentioned earlier that your mom is on the live. Like, thank you to your mom. Thank you to the UCLA organization for like being there to support you, right? Throughout whatever you're going through in terms of like still having to raise Levi, right? You talked about like having to figure out schedules and stuff like that. Like, it sounds like you have a great village supporting you. So shout out to your village, and especially like the organization, man, for believing in you, and taking, accepting all that comes with you. So super, super dope. So thank you. You want to also mention something super important is that you wear number 43. Why do you wear number 43?
So it's obviously a family number, you know, everybody knows who my uncle is. I'm like, eh, no, I'm just kidding. So I think I was the only one that's actually sat down with him and said, hey, uncle, is it okay if I wear the same number as you? I just like it. I don't know, like, I don't know what other number to choose. So I kind of want to wear that number because, you know, you made it so cool. And he was like, yeah, of course, go ahead. So it kind of just stuck with me. And I, you know, I just, and I'm so proud to wear the number and just everything that it stands for in my family. And it just the story that my uncle has and, you know, everything that happened behind the scenes for him to get to that point. Cause obviously when he was growing up and before he went to SC, I saw how hard he would work and everything. And that was just such a true inspiration. And I see Manny down there.
Yeah. Him. Yeah. Don't mind Manny right now.
You'll curtain forever. So yeah, it's like a family number, and it's just something that I hold near and dear to my heart. I swear this number, it's like my lucky number too. It's either 43 or 7, because 4 + 3 = 7. And
okay.
I've only ever worn 43 or 7 because of, you know, that superstition with me, like, that it's just my number. And I don't like to think of it as like, you know, I wear my uncle's number. I like to think of it as like we share numbers.
Oh, I like
Who's
that.
Your uncle?
Say his name, please.
My uncle's Troy Polamalu, yeah.
The GOAT. Ladies and gentlemen, the GOAT.
The greatest.
I'm not going to say anything, man. SC all the way. Troy, all the way, man. So Troy is your uncle. You wear 43. It's a family number. You also spoke about like the special connection that you have to 43. Do you mind sharing with our viewers how is Troy your uncle, if you don't mind?
So he's actually my mom's little brother. So he's the youngest of all, I think.
That's like super close.
He's the youngest of five of them. So.
Wow. So your mama and Troy is brother and sister.
Yeah.
we family, right, Manny?
Yeah, I'm Troy's. I'm your Troy's youngest son.
You're Troy's youngest son. Oh, he's subtle. That's so dope. How often do you talk to your uncle?
I talk to him on like a weekly basis. You know, I just randomly text him saying, hi, uncle, love and miss you guys. You know, just, I guess, normal stuff that families usually text each other when they miss each other. So,
yeah. That's so dope. And shout out to Troy Polamalu. Of course, we know he's the GOAT. We all know how big of a Steeler fan Manny is. And that's just so dope to just like connect the dots there. And I know that's super special too. I mean, all of us who follow Troy, we've been inspired by his story and all he's done, not only for the sport of football, but also for Samoa. Like, he's done so much for our people. Oh, yeah. So thank you, Brother Troy. We appreciate all that you do. And you actually have a big family that also play like NCAA sports. Want to talk about them?
Yes, I would love to give a shout out to all my cousins. Okay, so let me get started. So I have my cousin Kalaki. He plays football at Georgetown. I have my cousin Isaiah Polamau. He plays football at SC, actually. So a little headbutting right there. My other little cousin, he plays football at Nebraska. It's Noah Pola Gates. And then my little cousin actually plays softball at Nebraska, too. So that's my cousin KP. So
Nebraska.
So I got two, and then my other cousin actually goes to school in Nebraska too. So we got three of my little baby cousins that are in Nebraska, based out of Nebraska. So I'm so proud of them. I love reaching out to them and just randomly saying like, hey, I'm so proud of you for, you know, playing sports and the grind. Obviously I know how it is. And then I actually have other cousins who've played too. My cousin Selena, she played softball at Long Beach State. And then my other cousin Brianna Tautalafua, she played at UCLA before me, and my cousin Darian Tautalafua, she played at Long Beach State with my cousin Selena. So got a lot of family in the NCAA, and I'm so proud to rep every single one of their schools. I have a little hard time, you know, repping SC, but you know,
Come on, Genevieve.
I grew up an SC fan because of my
Hey, uncle. Look at that. Look at that.
I gotta rub my fours up all the time.
Oh, so. Yeah, you know, no. Hey, clap. I'm not mad. I'm actually grateful and thankful that we have somebody, you know, putting on for our culture, for Samoa. It means so much, man. There's so many young people on. I know my daughters are on. They're watching this live. They've been excited to, like, hear your story. They're young. And so many of my nieces and just family members who are on who are athletes. And so your story is super inspiring. Talk to us about what's happening, what's going to happen now with COVID, because obviously they cut the season short, right?
Yes. So I originally, you know, had been told that my career was going to be done because of COVID, since our season got cut short, because I had, so when I took my year and a half off, the year that I was off, it was technically my fifth year. So that could have been my last year playing. I got offered to go to Long Beach State for grad school. But at that point in time, I'd gone on a official visit while I was still pregnant. And I was like, you know what? I don't really see how I would be able to do all of this with a fresh newborn. And, you know, who knows how labor is going to go and just how that's going to affect my body and everything. So shout out to Coach P at Long Beach State too, for even thinking of me and giving me that opportunity. And then that half year would have been the start of my sixth year. So I had to actually put in a waiver to even be able to come back halfway through the year. And thankfully the NCAA had granted me that waiver. So I came back.
Nice.
And it's very rare for them to grant a seventh year waiver. So I don't know if, like, you guys see my Instagram and stuff, but on my post, when I was originally told that my season was done, I was like, hey, NCAA, are you guys going to grant me a seventh year waiver? Or is that even a thing? And then thankfully, I mean, I'm pretty sure at least, like, I'm going to be back at UCLA as long as I can be. I'll be in a uniform for as long as I can be in a uniform.
Let's go. Let's go.
So I'm going to be back next season for sure. So,
that's dope.
You know, God willing that we get our season because of all this COVID and how it's affecting, you know, everybody in the world and how it's affecting, you know, the Polynesian community in LA. It's actually being hit really hard. So, you know, hopefully, you know, God, like I said, God willing, everything works out and, you know, everybody heals and becomes healthy and COVID starts declining and everything. So I'll be back at UCLA next year though.
Oh, that's so awesome, man. And we definitely will be cheering you on,
of course,
from here, wherever we're at. And our prayer is that you will continue to thrive and do well down at UCLA. So thank you. Genevieve, before, I know we're nearing the end of this interview, but I want to give you some space to speak to our young people, our young listeners who are on right now. There might be a young Genevieve who's listening right now, who's listened to your story and who might feel like, okay, I don't know what the next thing is because I'm going through something similar or just facing any kind of adversity right now. I want you from your heart to speak to these young people, to speak to our young people right now. What would you say to them to inspire them?
I would say to really think about who you are and stay true to yourself and know.
That's good.
Like, know your drive and how determined you were before, you know, things had gone south or things kind of took a left turn for you, and to just continue to pray on it and to continue to push yourself. And I have always told anybody that's messaged me, because as soon as I started playing at UCLA, I received a lot of DMs from just athlete moms, from regular everyday moms, just and single dads. I get messages from everybody saying, like, you know, how did you do this? How do you do that? And I feel like I'm pretty good at responding to people. So if anybody needs a pep talk or, you know, needs some advice, like, I've been, you know, I kind of been around the sun a couple times. So I know a thing or two, and I'm always willing to give advice and, you know, just, yeah, I'm always here. I always try to be like a good, you know, person and respond and help people out and just try to motivate them to kind of get onto the mentality level that I'm at, because, and even my teammates too, I try to tell them too, that I'm older than you guys, so I know.
Yeah, there you go.
It's crazy. The incoming freshmen, they're all 17, 18. And on our first meeting with them, I told them, hey guys, when you guys were born, I was in second grade. So
wow.
but just to the young people, of today, just continue to stay strong. And, you know, there's a lot of things in society now that are just going to try to bring you down. Just to stay strong and to stay close to your faith and just to put everything to God and, you know, continue on and just continue to stay mentally strong. That's really the main concept that I want to get through, is that it's really everything is, it all starts up here of how your day is going to go. So
that's awesome. That's so awesome. Thank you for sharing that powerful message. And if you're on the live right now, Genevieve has graciously offered to help or talk or take the time to connect with anybody who might have any questions in terms of, you've heard her story. If you, you know, want to connect with her, how can they contact you? Via IG?
Yeah, on IG, you could just DM me. I'm pretty good at reading all of them and responding to anybody. So if anyone really needs that, kind of like that kick in the butt or that fire lit underneath you, then by all means, you can totally reach out to me. I love helping people to, like, inspire them to, you know, push themselves and kind of go out of their comfort zone. So
that's dope. That's dope. Any final shout outs you want to give?
Oh, I went this whole time without shouting out Levi. Hi, son. I love
you. Oh, yes.
I'll pick you up in a little bit. Okay. When we're done, I'm going to come pick you up. Don't worry. Oh, I miss you too.
Yes. Our best to Levi. We want to thank you, Genevieve, for taking the time to be with us. Our prayer is that the goodness of the Lord continue to follow you in your journey, and that you would continue to inspire folks, and that we will be rooting for you from afar or wherever we're at. And we just, that we would just pray that you would continue to speak your truth in light of what's happening or in light of whatever adversity folks are facing, to help inspire the next generation of leaders, athletes, whatever they are. So thank you so much. Our prayers for you and your family, your mom, we know she's on the live, and of course Levi, your entire family. And if you can, please let Uncle Troy know that we would love to have him on Big Hoos Radio for Manny's sake, right? Manny's sake. Any last words, Manny?
Or yeah, I just wanted to say, you know, echo what Boog was talking about. Thank you so much. You know, a lot of people would look at a story like this and be ashamed. You know, there's nothing to be ashamed about, especially if you walk through. You know what I mean? A lot of people only feel ashamed when they run away from it. And you've been a testimony of somebody who's walked through that and who's gone through it, and you're still doing it, and you're still climbing, and you're still climbing, and it never ends. But as long as you stay the right track, like you said, and find those people. I really love what you said about reaching out to other moms.
Yeah.
You know, because a lot of times we reach out to people who have not even gone through what we're going through.
Mm-hmm.
And then we end up hurting ourselves. And so it's really important to get those people who are experienced, who's walked through those fields, who's walked through those roads before. And so I just to you, this might be small, but it's huge. I really love this interview. Because of your story, because of what you've gone through, and then the best part about it was you being able to walk through all of that stuff.
Yeah.
And now you're trying to get your master's, and that's just amazing. So, thank you so much. I really appreciate you coming on the show and doing this.
Yeah, I really appreciate you guys for having me and allowing me to share my story. I just want to try to, you know, touch as many people as I can in that, like, and inspire them in any way that I can. So, thank you guys.
You're amazing.
You're super amazing. Thank you so much, Genevieve. Ladies and gentlemen, light up our live feed with those fire emojis for Miss Genevieve Perez. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much, Genevieve. Our prayers and our love to you.
They're asking for a Cash App.
Cash App? Do you have a Cash App?
They're asking for a Cash App. Oh,
no, it's okay. I don't know why you guys wouldn't send me the Cash App.
Okay. Well, the love is definitely being shown.
Yeah, the love is definitely
your story and your encouragement and your, you know, just everything. They love you. So a lot of fire emojis, a lot of 100 emojis and all of that stuff. So we appreciate you so much.
Thank you so much, Genevieve. Take care. God bless you. Our love to Levi and the family. Aloha.
Thank you.
Aloha
to you too. Thanks.
Take care. Whoa, bro.
No, that was so dope, man.
Yeah, that was a great interview, man. Gosh. She is... Bro, I mean, if you don't know who Genevieve is, if you're on the live right now, go YouTube her.
Yeah.
Like, she's got a big bat. That girl can play some fast pitch. right? I mean, she does it all. She is a beast on there. And just like to hear that story of perseverance, like having Levi and not giving up, and like, yo, she's in grad school. Like, that's just so amazing, man. So shout out to Genevieve for coming on Big Oosh Radio and sharing that story. We pray that whoever's listening, that you would be inspired, whatever it is that you know, you've been holding off, that you really want to do. Like, let that inspire you, man, to go and be great, whatever it is. You know, what I mean?
What was the biggest thing that you, like, what is the, I know she said a lot of things, but what is one thing that really stuck out for you that you can probably relate to, that you've gone through? Because, you know, we're a little bit older now and things like that, and just kind of circling back to think about our lives.
Like, here's the thing, though, right? When you're young, right, and everybody's on the live, like, real talk, right? No joking. When you're young, like, we have these dreams. Yeah. Like, the truth is, when I was growing up, like, I had all these dreams. Like, I wanted to be this, and I wanted to be that, right? And one of the dreams that I had was, like, to do music. Yeah. Right. If you know me, you know, like, that there's a big part of me that's passionate about music. And I actually thought at like 18, 19, I was going to be like doing music full time for something like that. Right. But then what happens is that life happens. It's like her. Like, you have a kid, you have right. You get married. And then all those dreams feel further away.
Farther. Yeah.
They feel like, I tell my kids all the time.
Talk to them, Book.
I'm like, yo, if I could go back, and I can't, I would I would do everything the right way. And my kids are like, what's the right way? I'm like, I would have went to school. Most of my youth, I wasted. Yeah. I wasted my youth, like, wanting to party, wanting to hang out. Like, I was chasing a dream that there was no meaning to not just that specific dream, but just anything. I was just so immersed in life and everything that the world in front of me, that I felt like I had to have those things, I had to be those things in order to be validated in terms of whatever my calling was. And you know what happened? I got the short end of the stick, because then you look back like, oh, there goes 10 years, right? Like, when I started taking like those theology classes, and I told my kids, like, yo, I'm like almost 40 years old in this class, right? Trying to take these theology classes after work, come home, and I'm like tired, like, my heart wants to do it, my body's like, oh, I don't want, you know. So I'm telling my kids, like, yo, you're young right now. Take advantage of your youth. Because the Bible speaks about the youth, about your youth, right, Manny?
Mm-hmm. And every season in your life. And to take advantage of your, you know, because every day we wake up, our window closes. You know, our window of influence, our window of just growing, you know what I mean? We get older and older and older, and our bones get older and our mind gets older. And one thing that we need to take advantage of is, especially now, we live in an age of, like, when we grew up, Oos, like, I remember when the cell phone first came out, you know what I mean?
Well, look, that's like a whole nother thing. The cell phone is like,
and then we get the, remember that dial up when you used to connect to your internet, it used to go, you know what I mean? So we're coming from that into what it is now.
Yeah.
And so I'm always encouraging, you know what I mean, my kids, Jaira, to take advantage of this technology, you know, take advantage of everything that's around you, because not only did I not take advantage of what was there for me that wasn't there for my parents, I also decided that, oh, I'm going to go do this instead of pursuing my dreams. And just like you know what I mean, we all have these things where it's called wasteful, you know, wasteful days. Oh, we feel like it. We look back and we're like, man, if I was 10 years ago, I should have did this and did this and did this. Here's an encouragement. You know what I mean? Because if you think of life that way, you're always going to wake up negative. Here's an encouragement for you, right? And this is what I got off of the interview. If you was somebody who made a mistake or stopped at your dream because something had happened for you, then you have kids to raise and you have nieces and nephews to raise. So teach them the right way now. You know what I'm saying? And so when a niece or nephew comes to you and say, oh, I'm going through this, teach them the right way to do it. Not what I've gone through, because I've stopped. I'm going to share this on the live, Oos. I went to college. I went to Bible school. I went to all of these things, right? And because life was throwing curveballs at me, so I just kept stopping everything. And then as I was getting older and older in life, I try to restart these dreams that should have been started 5 years ago. You know what I'm saying? And so now I got kids. I have to come to a realization that those are done now. I have to set new goals. but let me teach my kids that, hey, if you do mess up, you don't have to stop.
Yeah.
If life, if you end up at this dead end, you don't have to stop. Just turn around, walk this way. It might be a little longer and it might be a little rougher, but a little rougher is rougher a word. It might be more rough, but you don't have to stop like I did. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I mean, there's just so, you're right, man. And there's so many different elements of like that too, especially culturally, right? Because like, right, God bless mom and dad, right? And they did the best that they could, mm-hmm. right? But, right, because we never were making ends meet for the most part, yeah. right? There was always on this pressure. And because we operate as a family unit, it's like, yo, hurry up and graduate and go get a what? A J-O-B, right? It wasn't like, oh, hurry up and graduate and go to college. And after college, go get your master's, all right? And they weren't thinking that way because they wanted the least for us.
That's right.
It was because we were in survival mode, right? And we had to make sure that we could care and prepare and, right, take care of our families. But, and that's the one, that's the only way we knew how, right? And so they didn't come from, right? And I'm just maybe speaking from my own story. Like my parents, their parents didn't go to college. Yeah. Right. I remember my pops talking to me about like him and his grandfather or his father going fishing and then going to the market. Right. Wow. So they come from that. Right. Yeah. And so we're breaking these cycles now. Right. And I'm trying to do that with my kids. Like, yo, you go to college, get as much education, or if you don't go to college or whatever it is, be an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
Own the business. Right. How do you become the boss? How do you not just like. And not shooting down like any jobs or anything, but if you're working, you know, in a warehouse, how do you get to the top, right? Yeah. How do you learn? You know what I mean? Those kinds of things like that weren't taught to me necessarily because of any, for any bad reason, but it was just because there was just a lack of that type of knowledge.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? My pops didn't know about credit. You know what I mean? Until
he
came to America, going through a lot of mistakes. And then naturally we inherit a lot of those bad behaviors. Oh, I saw my mom and dad do this. Yeah. Right? I saw my mom and dad, oh, they didn't pay the whatever bill because we had to give $200 for a Fala Velave. Well, now I'm in the hole because, right? So they're all great things, but
it
like
just cycles over and
it just
over.
Cycles,
and over,
but how are we teaching our kids about spending, about finances, about breaking all a lot of these generational curses, you know? Yep. So
I think one of the dope things before we and this was, I want to address it. And Genevieve talked about this, but the being forced to get married just because the girl got pregnant.
Oh, jeez.
Bro, and I might piss some people off on the live, but I feel like I need to talk about it, Oos, because I have a lot of friends, Oos, who did that, who ended up getting together because, you know, being forced because they had a child together, and who ended up divorced today.
Oh.
You know what I'm saying? And so.
Yeah.
We got to break that cycle of thinking that way. You know what I'm saying? And people are like, oh, trust me, but I hid Gina from my parents until she was 7 months. It was 7 months pregnant. I hid because of that fear. It was, man, I'm going to have to get married and da, 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 and all of this stuff. And they're going to force me to do all of these things. And they did it. And I'm thankful to this day because of it. You know what I'm saying? They wanted to make sure that I was in love with my wife before I married my wife.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And just because you messed up, it doesn't mean you have to get forced to do something that wasn't part of the plan. You know, a lot of people, when they make mistakes, they try to cover it with another mistake.
Hello.
Sorry. I was talking to somebody back there.
Okay. You know
And then what we end up with is a life full of all these mistakes, and then we're all just cover-ups. Let's start another podcast.
Oh, that's a whole other podcast. Woo-wee, it's getting hot in here,
bro. We got to start another podcast, bro, because I can go on. But anyways, I just wanted to...
Oh, yes, bro. What, twins, all like,
huh?
That does look like...
A little bit, huh?
Let me see.
Sorry. I had to go in a little
does it,
bit.
Does it, can you guys see the resemblance there? Do you guys see the connection between Manny and Uncle Troy? Thumbs up, thumbs down, fire emojis? Yeah, let us know right now. Let me see. Ooh, yeah, they go... I see the resemblance, Juice. I can tell you. I know you look like Troy's water boy.
But he goes,
see, pass him the water. Pass him the water, Manny.
He goes,
no, but that's like real tough, man. You guys actually have a real family connection, man, which is super dope. And we learned that on in our time with Genevieve, that Manny's family and Genevieve, they're closely connected, man. And so they shared some of the same bloodline, which is super dope. So, Uncle Troy, we know you're watching right now. I see Troy on the live right now. Will you please come and be on the show, Uncle
bless
Troy?
Bless the podcast.
Please bless
Uncle
English Radio and come and rock the stage with us. What's going on, everybody, on the live? Let's see what everybody's talking about in here, bro. I know we kind of got a little deep there at the end, but like, we just like, we had to let that off, man. And there's like so many.
But so many I'm always going to get emotional. And you know what I'm saying? That's, you already know me. I always get like that on things that I'm very passionate about. And it seems like I'm mad or I'm sad or I'm this or I'm that. But I'm just very passionate about things that I believe in. And I never want to force a theology on anybody.
Right.
You know what
I'm
saying? Or a way of thinking to anybody. You know, everybody's their own. They can think their own and do their own lives. You know, I mean, I ain't no boss of you. But this is just from my experiences.
Yeah.
And then just watching people. We got to learn, like, when psychos, you know, like, what they say, what's the definition of insanity, Use? Doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result.
Outcome. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. All right, my boy, man, he's in his bag right now, bro. And there's so much wisdom on the live right now. I see, like, shout out to my also, Big Slim Dog. I see you. I see Naomi on here too, as well, man. Just like, just some of these. You guys are, you know, some of the older ones that, you know, for me, we look to, man. And like, shout out to Slim. I always said to Slim, like, he, like, when I first got into this work, working with young people, Slim was like, You know, always just there to push and inspire, like,
encourage,
encourage. There you go. Like, Vince, continue to do what you, I see what you're doing. Like, that's like, to me, the definition of a big Uso, somebody that's like, not somebody that's trying to build me up.
Yeah.
Right. And so we need just more of that building up. We need to be able to reach back to our, to these young cats. And that's part of what we wanted to do tonight with Genevieve, is like, say, you know, continue to build her up and her story, to get that out to the world so they can see what this amazing Polynesian woman is, young woman is doing, even with a son and going through all these, right?
Adversity.
And she's still trucking and moving forward and about to get her master's degree.
Getting her master's, bro.
Yeah. Super, super dope. So thank you to everybody that's on the live. I forgot to, for Genevieve. Genevieve, if you're watching, I forgot to ask you if you could send a shout out to my Uso Mac, Sal, who's a huge UCLA fan, man. That dude right there is just a clap all day. I forgot to ask her, but if you get a chance, Genevieve, would you please send a shout out to my also Mac Sal, who is a huge, big UCLA fan. So thank you. Thank you to everybody that's on the live. Make sure you rock with us. We're going to be back again here for Fire Fridays on Friday. And then we actually have a guest appearance. Well, not appearance, but we have another dope interview. Oy, son, man. Why'd you do that, bro? I'm just going to end it right now.
Too much bling?
That's a lot of bling.
Ladies and gentlemen.
That's a lot of bling. There you go.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
We see it. We see it. We see it. We see it. We see it, bro. We
sorry,
see it.
Boog. Sorry, Boog. If people don't know, Boog's a Baltimore Raven.
All day.
And I'm a Pittsburgh Steeler.
All
and
day.
Even in basketball, Boog is a
Lake LA Show, Laker, baby. Lake Show all day.
And I'm a Boston Celtic, so.
Huge rivalry between in our brotherhood. But,
yes, sir.
You know, it's good. It's good fun,
it's
man.
Love,
it's good fun.
It's love.
It's all love. Well, can you please take that picture off, bro? Suddenly, man, my eyes are hurting. Anybody else eyes hurting? From all those trash cans.
It is kind of bright.
It is kind of super bright on there, bro.
It is kind of bright.
Yeah, man. But next week, Tuesday, Jerusalem High. Do you have the poster?
Oh, you know what? I didn't send it to the laptop. I'm sorry, bro.
Okay. No worries. we have one of the hottest Polynesian music producers the game. Yeah. He will be blessing our show next Tuesday. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Mo Music will be on Jerusalem High next week, Tuesday. So make sure y'all tap in next Tuesday, man. He's produced so many hits for, like, David
Bizzle. They're going to find out.
Like, just, yeah, just so many, man.
They're going to find out who Mo Music is, brother.
Uso's in his bag right now, man. So tune in next Tuesday.
Because people only see the artists, but they don't see the stuff, you know, the behind-the-scenes guys, man. The producers, the instrument players, and all of that stuff, man. Absolutely. Mo Music is about to drop some heat next week, Tuesday.
Yeah, man. So make sure y'all tap in next Tuesday with Mo Music, man. We're going to be rocking with those. So any announcements on merch, bro?
Did you post that thing?
I did.
Okay. And so I've been running around like a chicken with his head cut off. And so me and Boog sat down. We kind of paused everything. And we found out a better system to get our merch going.
Yeah.
Shout out to everybody, first of all. Thank you so much. I don't want to tell you guys how much merch went out, but it's a lot. It's a lot. And so we just sent stuff to Australia, to Hawaii, all over. And people are listening. And one of the biggest blessings for me is you know, I get to deliver to some of the people local. And just to see the people's face when I pull up to the house and they're so surprised, you know what I mean? And we're both surprised, you know, I'm surprised off of their surprise and they're just so welcoming and so, you know what I mean, thankful and appreciative of the show and the feeling is mutual, Ollybug. Like we appreciate you guys.
Yes.
And you guys love and support for the show. And so merch will be available from Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And so you only have 3 days to order merch. And then Thursday, we'll be gathering everything, all our data from those 3 days. Friday, we do drop-off, right?
Mm-hmm.
At the print shop, at our guy at the print shop. And then everything gets delivered the week after that. And so that's the new system we're running with. Because I was me and Boog was going to the store almost every day and talking with our people and our team trying to get this thing going. So... We just figured out a new system, a better system, a more efficient system, and so that'll be better for us, and it'd be better for our custom, our people, our Big Ooze family, man.
Yeah. So there you go. If you need merch, we've posted the post on our social media, so we want to make sure that we're following those things, so that we can just stay in alignment with keeping track of all the orders, and we want to just thank you guys, like. Thank y'all for supporting BUR. Everybody that's copped a shirt or a beanie or a hoodie, thank y'all from the bottom of our hearts. We appreciate you guys. And if you need it, you know, we got it. Put those orders in and follow the directions that are on there. And support Samoan-owned businesses, right?
Yeah.
Support Polynesian-owned businesses. It don't matter what it is. If you got a plate sale, I always, like, try to share it. Or somebody's doing something, especially for our people, like, share it. Like, there's... Shout out to the Uso Mike, Family Clothing, like, right? Go to familyclothing253.com, cop some merch, right?
Yep.
Ollie Dope with Dope. DJ Una.
Taste of Samoa.
Taste of Samoa. Samoan Bakery. We got Lily's Bakery. Shout out if anybody follows Lily, she did a little post this morning, man, about whatever it is. I don't want to get into the negative stuff of it, but we just want to say Lily's Bakery, we stand behind y'all. They're a business. Operating out of Kent, Washington. And so support them. Thank you. Lily, she's purchased Big Ooze Radio gear. She's not only purchased gear, but dude, she's helped our community a great deal. Like anybody that follows us knows, like Samoan Culture Day, NHPI, we call on Lily. She's always there. Her and Pony are always there to help us out. Like sometimes I don't even have it. I'll be like, Lily, please, can you help bail me out? And she's right there. She'll come and like bring all this food and it's like feed all of our guests. Like, or she was like, Vince, bring them down to the store. I got them. Like, that's love. You know what I mean? Those are her own resources out of her own pocket. And so I know Edward is the same way. Yeah. Also, the Uso Les Fiola in Lakewood, who's been a long time running in the city of Lakewood, support these cats. And, like, I see a lot of these cats at the functions, too. They come back and they give to the churches, which is super dope, too. So support Samoan-owned businesses. Don't be a hater.
Don't. Don't be like the guy on our live last week Friday. Don't be that guy, okay?
Don't be that guy.
Don't be that guy.
Yes. Because talk about, some folks don't know. Everybody's like, well, what happened? Like, can you just give a real quick update on what happened there?
We were doing Fire Fridays, and we did the Battle of the Ox, King of the Ox Court. And you guys know what the story is behind that. Every party or every get-together, every function where we're playing music, there's always somebody that's like, oh, let me play my music. And so me and Boog decided, hey, why don't we do a friendly competition where we go back and forth and we just play the hits randomly, you know what I mean? Whatever you think will get the party jumping. And so I started it off. Then Boog came with a banger. I came with a banger. Then Boog came with a banger. Then I came with a, you know what I mean? And so it was back and forth and everybody was having a good time. And then boop, cut. Facebook shut us down because somebody reported us. What the person didn't know, or maybe he did, was that it tells us what we're getting flagged for. And so it said a viewer has flagged your video for nudity or sexual harassment, or, you know, you can pick all of these
inappropriate
choices,
yeah,
inappropriate language and all of these things. And so the person did it two times. Yeah. And so we just kept coming back because we ain't gonna let them win. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And so we ended it off with a bang. People love this show. We love the show. I've watched that episode probably like 8 times already. And so I told Boog, I said, you know what? I'm gonna combine these 3 videos and make one long video and just make it look like the hater was never there.
Yeah.
And we did that. And so subscribe to our YouTube channel.
Yes.
We got all those videos on there, every single episode. And I'm about to throw this one on top of YouTube, our channel, too, if you missed out on the beginning, middle, or end, like Jasmine did, because Jasmine just greeted us at the end of our episode. Thank you for joining us, Jazz. But, yeah, that's what happened last week. But, man, they just never seen the win, brother.
Nah, it's all good, man. It's all good.
I mean, negativity cannot win with good vibes against good vibes, bro.
All day. You know what so support someone. Old businesses. I see somebody posted. If you know somebody, post them on here. DTF photo booth.
Yeah, Lawn DTF candy. Photo booth. That's Dale and Tama. And so shout out to Dale and Tama. They got two. So their business got hit from COVID-19 as well, right?
Yeah.
Because they do the mirror thing where they take pictures and stuff at this fancy mirror and it does all these kinds of crazy stuff. But there's no parties no more. There's no social events no more. And so that kind of slowed down. And then they decided to open up another business called Lawn Candy where they do decorations on your lawn for graduations, parties, weddings, and all of these things. So shout out to them. That's another Polynesian-owned business.
And, please support
just like
them.
Old Book said, support our people, man. Support our people.
Slim said Roscoe's the one reporting us. Roscoe, man, better not be you, Roscoe. Love you, Mouso. So, thank y'all for joining us today for Jerusalem High. We'll see you guys again on Friday for Fire Fridays. Remember, we got more music.
Yes, sir.
Next week, Tuesday.
Yes, sir.
B-U-R, Manny and I, we are going to be signing off. Thank you to everybody for rocking with us. Godspeed to you all. I was doing a little something like this on Friday, huh, Manny?
That's beautiful. I'm telling you, I think you want us, for real. Mm.
Listen. I was about to spit something, man.
Listen. Go ahead.
Listen.
Let them know.
I don't want to burn up this mic right now.
Burn it up.
First person to hit that cast app, I'm going to spit a hot 16 right now. Nothing, if nobody hits the cast app, I'm just going to end it right here. First person to hit the BUR cast app, I'm going to spit this hot 16, baby. Listen. I don't see nothing in the cast app, bro. We got to just end it. Slim Dog, love you, Mouso. Love to everybody that's on our live.
Yes,
God bless
sir.
You all. Take care. God bless.